doing something successful in my life. It also pushed me to get my self-worth from things like video games or like TV shows, where momentarily I would feel like I have community or I have worth, but those things did not last. These periods of my life, which I can say were honestly the majority of my experience at youth group, created a constant insecurity for me. I wouldn't consider myself having been like seriously depressed, because I have very good days, I had very good weeks, I had very good months, but they just felt like something was missing, you know? I would just have these really good days, but I would feel like there's something more out there. I could be better, I could be living a different life, I could be impacting more people. This identity and worth issue continued on and followed me into college, because I just continued having these experiences of emotional highs with, you know what, this is going to be the new beginning of my life with Christ. This is going to be the moment that I change forever, and then it would proceed to just nothing happening, and then those emotions kind of stirring back up. When I got to college, I rushed a fraternity because it was like, that's the thing to do, you know? I'm in college, I'm gonna have the time of my life. And I found that my experience with being in a fraternity for the brief couple months that I was, it felt like I was redoing high school all over again. It felt like I was having these surface level conversations where everyone was trying to seek approval in themselves from others. And it just felt like I'm doing all the stuff that I've done before. What's going on right now? And it just felt like I wasn't having purpose to what I was doing. Now, that's not to say that all fraternities are bad, because I know a lot of guys that are in them and they're doing really good things with their lives, being really impactful and truly making a difference. But for me, it felt like I was wasting my time, and it felt like college, I was just redoing the things that I'd done in the past. Which led me to feel pretty alone, because I felt like I didn't fit in with my fraternity friends, and then it felt like I wasn't really close with anyone else that I ran into college, because I was busy spending my time around those people that I wasn't really enjoying my time with. So that made me feel, when I was all alone, like everyone else was having more fun, everyone else was doing their life right, and I was doing my life wrong. And during this confusing time, I was luckily introduced to some people that are part of the Wesley Foundation at UGA, which is pretty much like the Methodist youth ministry at UGA. And through that, I found people very similar to the community that I had here at WTL, people that genuinely cared about me, not for like the things, the funny things I could say or the sports that I played, but they cared about me just because of the person that I was. But the difference there than back at WTL was that some of these people were well-versed in their faith. And not to say anything rude against some of my friends at WTL, but we are still learning about our faith. We're still learning about what it meant to truly be a follower of Christ. And these people that I met at college were teaching me how to find my self-worth in God and not the things of this world. I realized that enjoying my time with these new people, I was having more fun and finding more like confidence and satisfaction in my life than I was with the fraternity that I was in. So I ended up dropping that. And even though I did that, I needed to move on from those friends and that group of people so that I could grow in myself. And over the past couple months, actually, I have had the opportunity to meet with and hang out with some of those old friends and kind of rekindle those relationships. But I needed that separation to grow more in my faith and grow more as a person. Now, that's to say that I'm definitely not done with dealing with insecurity today. To be honest, I was pretty nervous about stepping up in front of you guys just like a few hours ago. But I realized that this is something that I haven't struggled with by myself, and I'm sure that there are people in this room who are also dealing with insecurity and self-worth issues. So I felt the need to convey my story and also give you guys some pointers on what I figured out about how to deal with it, how to cope with it. First off, I do want to say that nothing against the baby boomers in the back of the room, but I think that our generation has it a little bit harder than theirs in terms of self-worth, because a huge thing is social media and the fact that everyone's putting their best face forward, and everything you see on Instagram and Facebook and any other social media platform is everyone's best, and you don't really see everyone's worst or when they're alone. You see everyone as their most extroverted and exciting self, and that's what you compare yourself to. You're like, you know what, that guy, he's always hanging out with his friends, he's always at parties or at games or at something like that. Why am I not like that guy? when really, we all struggle with loneliness, we all struggle with insecurity, we all struggle with self-worth. And I think that it's really important for people to be honest with themselves and start confessing these struggles that they have in order for people to feel better about themselves. Self-confidence that I found was based in my community of people that care about me and listen to me, and it was important for me to listen to their evaluation of who I was rather than that little nagging voice that I think all of us have in the back of our heads saying, you're not good enough. But although that community I found at college that really transformed my life was hugely impactful for me, and I think they're very transformative in terms of the kind of person that I can be, it's not lasting. I think that the most important thing that I want you guys to hear tonight is that you can find lasting self-worth as a child and friend of God, and that is the only way that you can find lasting self-worth. Because unlike people, God does not look at someone's past mistakes or their past victories. God does not look at someone's situation as not good enough or just right. And God certainly does not look at your outward appearance or your talents in a classroom or sports field. God simply calls you to love one another and also to love yourself. Now, in order to get a break of my droning voice over and over again for the next 2 minutes, I wanted to show you guys a clip from one of my favorite movies over the past year, and I think that you will enjoy it as much as I have.
Do you like anything?
It's not that.
Sometimes the world seems against you. The journey may leave a scar, but scars can heal and reveal just where you are. The people you love will change you. The things you have learned will guide you. And nothing on earth can silence the quiet voice still inside you. And when that voice starts to whisper, Moana, you've come so far. Moana, listen. Do you know who you are?
Who am I? I'm a girl who loves my island. I'm the girl who loves the sea. It calls me. I am the daughter of the village chief. We are descended from voyagers who found their way across the world. They call me.
Goosebumps every time. I love that. I love that movie. I love that movie for so many reasons, but the main one has to be that I think it's an incredible story of empowerment and something that really I think that a lot of kids in our generation can learn from, because finding our identity is something that I think is a huge struggle and something that comes up constantly throughout our entire lives. If you want to get really symbolic with it, I guess you would say that the ghost of her grandmother was God pointing to the fact that he or she loved her no matter what, loved her identity, loved everything about her. And I think that we just need to somehow get that into our minds, that the creator of the universe, not just the ghost of our grandparents, truly loves us for who we are, loves us for the identity that we have. And wants us to just be empowered, be encouraged with that. And if that wasn't enough, I've got some biblical examples of God using people to lay the groundwork for faith as we know it today. And I think that these examples were incredible because these people had a much darker past than anyone, I think, in this room. You might have heard this before, but if you want to go to the next slide, I think it's really impactful to hear because these are all really important biblical characters. And I like to run through it. Ooh, nice. That's pretty small. Well, I'll read it out to you. Abraham lied, Moses stuttered, Jacob was a liar, David had an affair, Solomon was too rich, Jesus was too poor, Abraham was too old, David was too young, Peter was afraid of death, Lazarus was dead, Paul was a murderer, so was Moses, Jonah ran away from God, Jeremiah was depressed and suicidal, Elijah was burned out, John the Baptist was a loudmouth, Noah got drunk, Moses, Peter, Paul, and many more had very short fuses. And these were the most revered characters in the early church. And for a lot of them, they had really rough situations. But that just goes to show you that God doesn't care about your past mistakes. God doesn't care about what situation you're in. He can use you in any way, and all he really wants from you is to be in a relationship. That's it. He's just calling to us over and over again to be in relationship with us. Paul's letter to Romans was very impactful in terms of beginning the early church, but his chapter 8 really, I think, covers pretty well his thoughts about God's relationship with people and how God overlooks everything that you've done in your past as long as you just be in relationship with him. Romans 8:1, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That's just the beginning. But this pretty much reiterates the point I was making above with the biblical examples that no matter what's happened in your past, God can still use you and God still loves you. The rest of the passage, I think, is one of true empowerment, and I would love to share that with you right now. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do in that it was weakened by the sinful nature. God did, by sending his own son in the likeness of a sinful man to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in a sinful man in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the sinful nature, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit. If the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of your sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. I just think that that is incredibly empowering and incredibly encouraging. That's pretty much Paul's telling to the church that as long as you're in relationship with Christ, you will live abundantly. You will live without sin, and you will truly live the life that God's calling for us. I think that that's an amazing passage. But next, what I wanted to tell you guys was, although everything I've said here was really important, I do want to give you guys some practical steps to actually living a life geared towards Christ. If you want to hit the next slide. Next slide, sorry. So, some practical steps would be, I would love for everyone in this room to start not questioning your faith in the way of like pointing out all of its flaws, but truly thinking about your faith and then having conversations with people about that faith.
Also,
reading. Don't want to give you guys homework, but I do want to say that if having this life where you're committed to a relationship with Christ is truly important to you, then scripture has to be a part of that. And becoming a fluent person in the scripture of the Bible is so important and like integral to being a follower of Christ. Also, living a life of love is something that I've heard a lot, and something that, although it sounds kind of cheesy, it's truly what having a relationship with God looks like and what it's about. And then prayer, which is arguably the most important out of those four, I think is sometimes the hardest to do, because a lot of times, like what I experienced going through youth group, you feel like you're just talking to the air. Nothing's happening, you're not getting anything in return, but prayer is so much more than that, and I'm gonna dive into that a little bit deeper. But first, talking about questioning your faith and doubts, next slide. I wanna call you to question your faith, but do so with other people. Do so through reading a book and kind of diving into the mind of the author. I want you guys to truly look at your faith for more than just what you hear at Sunday school, what you hear at WTL. Because the huge thing that impacted my life was figuring out that faith was personal. Faith was about your relationship with God and not about the pastor's relationship with God or not about your parents' relationship with God. It's about you and God. And that comes with you kind of stepping out of your comfort zone a little bit to try and learn more. This can be incredibly frightening because some people might look at you and, well, actually, I don't think that anyone should look at each other and label them as a bad Christian for questioning, but sometimes it can feel like that. Like, a lot of my best friends growing up were all Christian, and I felt like, if I start trying to question this faith, what are they going to think of me? Are they going to think that I'm some weirdo that's like, that is trying to be different or trying to be a revolutionary? And a lot of times questioning your faith can make you a sort of like leader in terms of your friend group, can actually be an example for other people to truly look at their faith and look at their religion from a different view. And not just to have these thoughts in your head, but to truly vocalize them, to truly pursue conversations with people like the adults in the back of the room or like Murph up here or each other, because I think that the people in this room can have some incredible opinions, incredible thoughts about faith, and just a lot of times we just don't want to talk about that because it's not small talk, it's not normal to have these deep conversations. But for those of you that are desiring something more, I think that it's hugely important to sit down and actually start discussing your faith. And what I've seen is that most people are actually extremely willing, if not excited, to have conversations about faith. Next slide. Another thing that I found very important was reading. And like most people, honestly, I'm not a huge reader. I don't like it unless it's Harry Potter. And it's just, I think that a lot of times we get crammed with all these like books at school and it's just like, oh, it's not fun, it's not interesting. But I really just hope that that doesn't carry over towards reading about religion. Because for me, for a long time, I was just like, nah, I don't really feel the need to look at books. Books aren't me. I'm more of a verbal person. I like to talk. But becoming well-versed in not only your Bible, but other books on faith can make the world difference in terms of how deep or good your relationship with Christ is. There are books out there by people that are so intellectually sound in their faith, they can almost become like a conversation. Like if you're reading a book by Brian McLaren, for example, it feels like you're talking to him almost. And having those books can be so impactful to growing your faith and actually hearing other viewpoints and hearing other ideas. Also being well-versed in your Bible, not only to just be a Sunday school expert, but also to truly be able to have a grasp on what your religion comes from, what your faith comes from. That's something that I took a long time to actually desire and something that still I have struggled with, but I find that actually pursuing your Bible as a tool for your relationship with God can make the world difference. Next slide. This is the, in my opinion, the best part, because this is actually like doing something. When I grew up, that's all I wanted to do. I wanted to do stuff. I wanted to serve people. I wanted to love on others. I wanted to do the serving part of Christianity, which is awesome, but also you need the faith to give you the endurance and the power to actually do that successfully. But once you have that background, once you have that support system, once you have that community and that true relationship with Christ, I think that this next step comes really easily. And this requires some self-worth that is centered on the relationship with Christ. Being able to look someone in the eye and truly love them, I think that that comes from God. And that's something that you need to have a relationship with Christ to truly do successfully. Some things that this can include are reaching out to those that are struggling with insecurity, reaching out to those that look like they're alone and need a friend. This also can be loving those that typically you wouldn't consider your friend, loving those who you might consider your enemy, who might be insulting or just not being really that nice to you. I think that that's a huge part of truly living a Christ-centered life, is being able to step away from your pride and to love those who clearly don't have the reciprocating feelings towards you. Also, another huge thing is putting others beyond yourself. And that can look like spending time serving others through whatever available avenues you have, whether that's the programs that the way provides for service opportunities, whether that's something at your school, like a can drive or something like that. Spending your time focused on helping others can completely transform your relationship with God. And then also just a really simple thing, sometimes just smiling at someone or having like giving them a little hello can mean the world's difference to them. I think that for me personally, some of the most important moments can be when someone you really look up to just gives you the time of day. It's something that I think that we've all experienced, and something that I think is transformative. And it's important for you to know that there are people that look up to each and every one of you, and you providing them that like attention can mean the world's difference. Also wanted to point out that this is not an easy thing to do, and I'm pretty bad at a lot of it, so just want to throw that out there. But if you have that faith background, it can make the world's difference. And lastly, prayer, which I find to be honestly the hardest thing for me, but what I've learned in college so far is that this can be the most important. I just want to encourage you each and every morning to wake up and start your day with prayer, because God wants a relationship with you, and relationships require communication. Oddly enough, if you didn't know that, there's your lesson for the day. And prayer, starting out your day with it, can just completely change the way you look at the world, the way you look at your friends in school, the way you look at your not-so-friends in school. I think that starting out your day with prayer and with communication with God can completely change your outlook on life. I would encourage you to pray for the forgiveness of your sins, because something about that, whether or not you've had a really bad day, praying for the forgiveness of your sins just makes you feel clean and like ready to pursue an active role in the day to come. I would also encourage you to pray for your eyes and your heart to be open to the struggles and the sufferings of those around you. That's a hard prayer to pray, but I think that it's so crucial if you want to be a follower of Christ to truly have compassion and empathy in your heart. And also a tough prayer that I have been praying a lot lately is prayer for you to feel empty without God. Because for me, like I told you earlier on, it's so easy to slip into that feeling of just running through the roller coaster of faith, going up and down and up and down, and not truly having purpose behind it. And I think that having a call to feel empty without God truly instead builds a desire in you to pursue that relationship wholeheartedly. So yeah, those are just some of the big things that I wanted to point out to you guys tonight. First off, I just want to recap. I would love for you guys to truly find yourself worthy of God, first of all, because God loves each and every one of you. The creator of the universe loves each and every one of you, and that should be mind-blowing. That should be amazing and transformative in your lives. And then also, with that knowledge that your self-worth comes from God, pursue God daily. Pursue God by having conversations with people about your faith, by reading scripture, reading books about faith, by praying, and by serving God and truly loving on other people the way that God would want you to love others. I think that that's huge. So those are my main points. Lastly, I just want to thank you guys so much for giving me the opportunity to come up here and talk today, because once again, I think the McKinsey was my first family and truly the community that helped me grow into the person I am today, whether that's good or bad. But I just love the fact that I'm able to come back here and see that there are still awesome things happening at this church. And depending on time, which we still have time, I would love for us to kind of take one of the steps that I talked about and put it into practice right now. So something that I was really uncomfortable with for a while, but found incredibly transformative, is praying over someone else. So tonight I would love for us to get the opportunity to split up into groups of two or three and to truly just have the opportunity, if even for just 10 minutes, to pray over each other, to be honest with each other and tell each other about what's going on in our lives, and for just the other two people or other person to just pray over them and let them know there's someone here that's caring about you, there's someone here that wants whatever's going on in your life to improve and get better. If we could possibly play some music in the back, I'd love for us to do that, breaking up into groups of two or three and just being honest with each other and praying over each other for the next 10 minutes. Thank you very much.